your mind as being a Marxist right there. Yes.
Rahul Sanskrityayam.
Rahul Sanskrityayam.
Anath is the work.
Yes. And anybody else? Rahul Sanskrityayam was influenced by Gorky.
Gorky.
So you will find that Rahul Sanskrityayam, a class Brahmin, he was a Brahmin, and for the feminist present over here, I would say that he also left his wife in the village. Right? He was a married person, that's something, you know, which is a very less known fact. So why is he Marxist? Any ideas about that? What is there in his works which allows us to say that it's a Marxist piece of literature?
It deals with the, in a way, suffering based on class and caste.
Yes.
And even Premchand, up to some context, you can say, while talking about, there is a very small story, Gilli Danda.
Yes.
And in that, towards the end of the story, it begins with a Dalit, between a Dalit and a Jamindar boy, both kids playing together Gilli Danda. But after for 30-40 years, when that Jamindar boy retires from the job and comes back, and that his same friend is old. Now their class is, you can say, superimposed on their personality, and they started playing Gulli Danda again. But that Dalit started losing deliberately before his master just to please him. And towards the end, after that, he says that he invites him that you please come in our community, we are having to going to have a Gilli Danda match. Then he visited there and his eyes were broadly open to see that how brilliantly his friend is playing.
Yes.
Whom he was defeating yesterday.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then he started thinking that now he cannot compete his own friend, because he is the subject of sympathy of his friend.
Yes.
And not at the equal platform, both of them cannot play, because the rich is having diabetes and other problems and so many things, maybe
no,
health issues.
Diabetes
not, but I'm thinking that way, maybe modern day problems, but maybe health problem. He was showing sympathy only, so maybe any reason. Background is not mentioned,
yes.
The gap is clearly, you can say, visualized, and says that there could not be friendship between a Dalit and a
yes.
Jamindar.
That's a wonderful story, and if I recollect it correctly, it ends in a very sad perception by the elitist friend, you know.
Mm-hmm.
He is so sad that he cannot now actually play with anything with his friend, with their, right, okay, remember the name correctly, right? So you would find that Premchand has narrated this story only on the basis of class differences.
Totally.
Have the modern day interpolations do not exist, right? So, but you are very right in giving us this example. Now, I can refer to Gorky also, and everybody would be familiar with Gorky's mother, even if you have not read it. So you would find that this was, you know, hailed as a first communist novel, because it has talked about the participation of the families in the freedom struggle of the Russian people. And Gorky has talked about how a particular class, a particular section of the downtrodden people are empowered because of this vision of having a classless society. So you would find that Marx also says that even though literature has to be put in a historical perspective, the contradictions between classes keep our society alive, but at the same time, it is these contradictions which also threaten to rip it apart any time, and literature may diminish the necessity of using police force. Now, you would find that the first two points are contradictory. Now, contradictions between these two classes, the haves and have-nots, for the convenience, the bourgeois and the proletariat, etc., it is these contradictions which economically help our society to survive and also flourish, right? Because without it, the society would not be able to gain anything. But perpendicularly, it is these clashes also which threaten to rip it apart, right? If we are not able to control these contradictions, for example, if the labor unrest is very much there, then you would find that the society would actually rip apart as nowadays we are looking at, you know, all those movements of the farmers, and when if the farmers would stop working, then the society would not be able to sustain itself. Now, in order to control these contradictions, the state as a coercive power uses force, the police force, the military force. It also uses certain institutions related to law and law enforcement for it. But literature, culture, and media diminish the necessity of using police force. And how do they diminish this significant, I mean, this reliance on police force? By educating the people in a certain manner. And therefore, for Marxists, literature and media is not independent. It is to be highly controlled, because by controlling the media, you control the mindset of the people. And if you control the mindset of the people, you do not have to use force to ensure that they would work in a certain manner. What Marx was doing here was perhaps not new, because even prior to Marx, we find that people were doing almost the same thing. They were highlighting the elite, the rich classes, the kings, the prince, the princesses, the statesmen, the wealthy. What Marx did was to replace these people by the have-nots. But then he has very argumentatively talked about the significance of literature, culture in a particular way, and media in such a way that it can be used as a tool to diminish the significance of reliance on the police force. And that is why the haves have also used it in the past, and have nots also intend to use it actually meaningfully. They do not want to leave it aside. Literature for them is not something which is a matter of laser, as Bertrand Russell has said, as many other people have said. In fact, in many ways, Marx sometimes reminds me of Plato. When Plato has said that a poet should be banished from the ideal state. In the same way, we find that Marx is also recognizing the power of a poet, of a literature person, of a media baron, but instead of banishing this person, he wants to utilize the services. That is the only difference. So context for the Marxist media theories is thus defined to be a part of the ideology. We often use this word ideology without actually bothering about what is the difference in the Marxist understanding of the term and the layman's understanding of the term. For Marx, it was the ruling ideas of the ruling classes. The ideology was the ruling ideas, the main ideas of the ruling set, of the ruling classes only. Later on, it was thought to be a process of cultural signification and personal formation. But even then, it was not devoid of the Marxist interpretation of the thing. And it also consists of training in practices of self-discipline or certain modes of self-identification. In a way, media controls these choices within the ideology. So when we talk about practices of self-discipline, when we talk about having certain models of behavior and idealism, etc., then they are controlled by the media propagation. And whosoever controls the media controls these choices. And unfortunately, people think that it is their own choice, wherever they only are making a sergeant bad choice, right? The choice is invariably corrupted. Okay. So that is how Marx wanted to use the media. Now, the media itself, you know, when we look at the development of the media theories, then we have to be aware that the development of the media theories was at a later date. Marx had already died, and when he was about 40 years old, that was towards the end of the 19th century, he had travelled to Russia and had tried to talk to the people over there. But then, you know, at the time, it is said that he also met Lenin, though I don't have any very favorable record of it. But it is said that, you know, he had talked intensively to the Russian leaders in the later stage of his life. However, it was after his death that the full impact of Marxism was started to be felt by the people, and the Marxist media theories may be divided roughly into these three ways: the reflection theory, which developed his reflection theory and was named as cultural materialist in the UK with certain changes, the Frankfurt School, which is based in Germany, and the structuralist criticism. Now let's very briefly look at these three differences. Then I will focus on what exactly are the central ideas of these three different media theories. Now, reflection theory and cultural materialism. The cultural materialism is in small font because here I am talking about the reflection theory. Now, it's a study which talks about relations between literature and social history. It is often told, often named as a reflection theory, because they think that literature holds a mirror to the historical world. It reflects the historical world, and therefore it is known as the reflection theory. But the mirror is not very simple. It can be a complicated mirror, right? Because it is not showing the contemporary reality. Literature is holding a mirror to the historical world, and the historical world is bound to be a complicated world. So when literature is trying to trace the origin and the relation, the relationships with the historical world, it has to be a complicated one. Now, George Lucas had cited the example of the early 19th century novelist Walter Scott, who was extremely popular, and he had painted the figures of war heroes, right, in almost all his stories and novels. So what he had talked about is about those heroes who can mingle between the two classes, right? They basically belong to the elite class, to the warrior class, which has certain prerogatives, but they are also very popular with the masses. So they are able to straddle these two, you know, different classes, and then, you know, bring about some type of a reconciliation, which was a historical hope, but never a historical reality. Then Christopher Claudel has also criticized Shakespeare by saying that ultimately he was a court person, and therefore he has not been able to talk about the government in general. Now, cultural materialism was the title which was given to this, the same theory, and often we think about this, you know, in the context of Raymond Williams, and became very popular in 1950s and 70s in the UK. It focuses on the sociological dimensions of culture as well as the structures of feeling. Now, Raymond Williams' arguments are, you know, summed up in the next point when he says that the feudal tragedy depicts rebellion as negativity, a failure. In the feudal writers, we find that the rebellion is always a failure, right? What is the earliest rebellion novel or story which comes to your mind?
Earliest?
Yes.
Slaves.
Slaves, yes, very right. I also have that in my mind. What's the title?
Leroy Jones.
I'm not able to recall it right now, but you may be correct. Yeah. Okay. So that's a story of the slave rebellion.
There is a dialogue that rebellion is not a stone thrown against temple, rather it is a circle of a lover's hand.
Okay.
And he said that I am not crying against individuals, rather I am crying against 300 years of slavery.
Yes, 300 years of slavery.
Slavery, and white people tortured blacks for 300, so now it is the turn of black to take the revenge and reverse the cycle for next 300 years.
Okay. The novel which I have in mind is based on the Greek slaves. The title and the writer has escaped me, and I have become more person really. So, but you would find that these tragedies were the feudal writers. But the writers who belong to the rich section of the society, they always perceive rebellion as something negativity, which at best has been able to create a ripple, a disturbance, but then the ripple vanishes, the disturbance is also resolved. Where is the liberal in the previous one, please? The previous one. Okay. You would find in liberal modernist tragedy, it can also be interpreted as a progressive change. So here we find that Raymond Williams has taken up the older paradigms and has tried to rewrite them in today's Marxist terminology. The Frankfurt School is an informal name which is given to people, you know, who are working at any university in Frankfurt, and you would find that though it originated with the Marxist thinker, very soon we find that it became a place of sheltering all those people around the two world wars who were neither satisfied with the traditional capitalist society, nor they were satisfied with the way things were unfolding in Russian socialist state. Next, please. The structuralist criticism reviews how texts display the way literature is anchored in social structures and contradictions that undermine their stated conclusions. So the structuralist media Marxist criticism is very different from the traditional understanding of structural criticism. Right? So people who are, you know, famous in this, you know, as critics of it, I would particularly mention Pierre Thatcher's book on Jules Verne's 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. Now, this very famous novel, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, was often hailed as a victory of sciences. Victory of sciences over the elements of nature. And Nemo became a very heroic figure. But then Pierre says that it is also supported by a pre-existing history of repression and exploitation about which people are silent. Now, so we find that, I mean, if you want, we can take up, you know, these three different strengths of media Marxist theories independently also. But prior to that, let us try to police them together. And after this collision, let us look at the angles of commonality therein. So the conservation of media theories started in the 20th century. It's a byproduct of changing definitions of culture. Right? So we find that at the turn of the century, somewhere around 1950s, 60s and 70s, the definitions of culture started to change. Prior to that, it was associated with art, literature, classical music, etc. And to be a cultured person meant that this person had a particular refined taste in terms of art, literature, etc., etc. So, anthropologists had always used this term in a broader sense, forms of life and of social expressions. So the way people behave while they are eating, talking with each other, becoming sexual partners of each other, interact at workplace, educational places, etc. In the morning I was talking to the expert, Professor Bakshi, who is now teaching in Saudi Arabia. So I was talking to him about the way classes are conducted, and he told me that there is no concept of, you know, poor education. So it's something that is very different for us. But you would find, yes.
One university started, first co-educational university in Saudi Arabia is King Faisal University. I was selected there for girls' college, but I didn't join.
Okay. So it may be a co-education institute, but the girls' wings is always separate.
Separate.
They are not seated in the same room like we sit here.
Even classroom teaching is not.
Classroom
they will
teaching
be,
is not possible.
They will be stationed somewhere else. You will
yes.
teach from mic.
Yeah.
And they will raise their question.
Yeah,
and a
yeah.
precaution was given to me that you will answer all the queries, that too not being too personal.
Okay. So you
would
find that the understanding of culture becomes different for a person who lives and grows in a particular type of society. So their understanding of education would be very different from the education as one understands it in the Western world. Forget about Indian society. Right? So you would find that it is a ritualized social behavior, family gatherings, etc., a broader understanding of people which was always shared by the anthropologist. So Marxism, you know, goes a step ahead. It says that culture is political. Right? For anthropological, it is social, but for Marxists, it is not merely social. They say that it is cultural. It's a means of domination. Assuring the rule of one class or group over another, patriarchy, maybe, it may be race, it may be colonization, etc. But it is always discriminatory. But at the same time, remember those points where we have said that these contradictions allow the society to continue as a whole unit, and at the same time, it also has a potential to rip itself apart. In the same way, it's a means of domination, but the culture can also be a means of resistance to such domination, a way of articulating opposition, point of view to those in dominance. And particularly in the first couple of decades of the 20th century, it was in the second way, second meaning, that Marxism was often associated with media and culture. Now, you will find that now I have started talking about media and culture in one breath, right? Because media is also a part of our understanding of culture. And had Marx been alive today, he would have also perhaps not distinguished between the two. Certain facts are already established. Marxist media theories are basically his views about literature as he found it in his times. In his times, the newspaper even was not circulated and printed in the way we understand it today. And of course, you know, he could not have envisaged the internet revolution. But let us say that the basic arguments of Marxist theory keep on having their impact on the way these policies and institutions are being structured, interpreted, and within them we find that the possibilities of, you know, dissent are also growing. So here we come across as these two people, Theodor Adorno and Max Horkheimer, who are related with basically with the Frankfurt School of Media Theories of Marxism. They have said that the mass culture is a tool of domination. And what exactly is a mass culture? Mass culture is the culture of TV, radio, films, cheap paperbacks, and if we go a step ahead, please also keep on adding their substitutes in the social media, right? So you would find that this mass culture is basically a tool of domination, an attempt to have this tool of domination, a way for capitalists to offer ephemeral gratification to people contained to lives of work. And work is not only physical, but anything which is repetitive and not linked directly with explicit goals or tangible objectives. Now, their definition is something, you know, which I find to be very interesting. Right? They say that it's a tool of domination because it puts, you know, before us an ephemeral gratification. So you have been working throughout the day in a situation which is not very conducive to your mental and physical well-being. So you come home, you relax in front of the TV, and what do you look at the TV? It's an opposite. Right? Okay. So what aspects of culture are being showcased before you? If it is controlled, then they are also providing you certain ephemeral escape. An escape which is not exactly possible for you. But at the same time, it gives a diversion to your mind, gives you a dream which you also know can never be a successful dream. But at the same time, it becomes, you know, like a sleeping pill. You look at this particular TV serial, you look at a particular, you know, movie, right, where the hero kills so many bad people and becomes a victorious and saves the heroine. You know very well that in actual life it never happens, but they provide you an escape. And simply because they provide you an escape, ephemeral gratification of your senses, it does your sensitivity, does your sensitivity to understand that there should be some protest, right? And that is why they are a tool. Media is a tool. Unless and until you understand that your work is linked with certain explicit goals. So this is the Frankfurt criticism. There are certain of the Marxist theories who go a step ahead and say that even if everything is repetitive, etc., it is linked with certain visions of explicit goals and tangible objectives. And this idea has been showcased in Orwell's famous novel 1984, right? Those of you who have read 1984 would find that most of the people are given not only this ephemeral dream, they are also taught to have a firm belief in its tangible translation to reality, right? So this is what media as a tool is meant to be. Now in Britain also, we do have, you know, Raymond Williams and others, and who thinks that culture is a means of resistance to capitalism, right? If the Frankfurt School had said that it is a means to continue the exploitation of the people, etc., then they also say that culture is also a means of resistance to capitalism. Look at the inbuilt inherent poor working classes away from intellectual instruments that might impel them to rebellion, then literacy in the form of clandestine pamphlets, underground newspapers also was a way of maintaining and nurturing alternative perspectives to these demanded by the progress of industrial capital, etc., etc. Now, the second point, you know, if we focus on it, we find that they have used a literacy as a tool, a cultural literacy as a tool of resistance, right? And it is particularly relevant in the Russian Revolution, which occurred in 1917, the Chinese Revolution, Indian resistance to the British forces, those newspapers like whether in the USA, the Chan magazine, the particularly which is called as the Farsi, Chan magazine, in India, etc. So what exactly these people have been on? Remember that the date of the publication of the first newspaper was 1874 in another form. So we find that in the early decade, the first decade of the 20th century, circulation of newspapers among the poor classes was not a reality. Particularly in those countries like Russia and China, which were a feudal society, newspaper circulation, if at all it was there, it was very limited. There were pockets of these countries where it was still a dream. So, in the absence of these circulated proper qualitative circulation, what these revolutionaries banked on? They banked on printing pamphlets, handbills. And we find that in all early 20th century revolutions, this helped the people to create a revolution. Those of you who have read about the decades before preceding 1917, the decades leading to the Chinese Revolution, decades leading to Indian independence, right? You would know that every party was printing handbills. People were, you know, intercepted, they were jailed, their material was destroyed. Gorky's mother, the whole novel is based on the success of passing on certain pamphlets, and the pamphlets also became the lifeline of resistance because they were the only means of understanding whether our revolution is becoming a success or not. During the First and Second World Wars also, when radio transmissions was also not very effective because of the technological status of things, people depended a lot on newspapers, on handbills, on anything which was written. And because of this dependence, a particular cultural attitude has been developed in the early 20th century that the printed word is the truth, right? For us also, it is very difficult to negate something which has come out in print. Oh, it is printed in the newspaper. Times of India mein aaya hai, chikki hoga. BBC ne announce kiya tha, chikki hoga. So, look at this reliance which we people have in our minds on these media channels. So, in these changing definitions and perspectives, the continued threat of technology and its impact on social life, media and market forces can also be perceived. And this is also something which the Marxist critics have always been champions in utilizing. How much time do we have? 10 minutes, okay. So I'll try to, you know, finish it within 10 minutes, but it's very difficult. So you would find that the technology has become very important. The first significance of technology is seen in the innovation of the printing press. Though it took several centuries before its true potential could be held, we find that it was successful. Then now we find that in the revolution in the early 20th century, these developments also took place, and where the revolutions depended on the printed word. And we have seen how in the beginning of the 20th century, the three different strands of media theories of Marxist variation developed to understand how media, the printed word in that situation, could be used. Also trying to remember that till the middle of the 20th century, media meant the printed word by and large, and later on, the radio programs. Sorry,
the fifth.
Let me know in 5 minutes before, and I will write.
Now, the significance of media is so vast that it can change the cultural habits which have been ingrained by centuries, life and of the people, and still people accept it. So, illustrating some facts to help us in understanding this significance, so that we can also understand that if a government, if an institution, if a philosophy like Marxist philosophy wants to use it, how serious the tentacles can be, right? So here are certain examples. So there are images of Santa Claus, right? When we think of Santa Claus, what is the image which comes to your mind? Old man, red cap, pot belly person, white beard,
with a bag in hand.
Yeah, with a bag in hand, on the gifts. Gifts, right. So basically, it cannot be a young man, it has to be an old man. Cannot be a woman, of course, right? Then the dress has to be red, right? Why red? Why red? Do you have any origins of any idea of the origins of Santa Claus' story? It's basically a Nordic myth, right? It's not a myth which is based in England. It's not a myth which is based in America. It is a Nordic myth, right? Those Scandinavian countries, etc. There, the image of the Santa Claus is very different. Santa Claus is old, bearded person, but a lean and tall figure, right? Imagine the difference in the physical build of a Nordic person and a Spanish person, for example, right? The height would be different, okay? So it's a tall and lean old person with a beard, and traditionally the dress is blue, right? In certain countries, particularly in Sweden and in Finland also, when they carry out these Christmas parades, the Santa Claus is not dressed in red, it is dressed in blue, right? So why is it that media has created this myth of red-dressed, pot-bellied Santa Claus? There was thought about a Coca-Cola advertisement in the US. Don't remember the exact date when Coca-Cola was invented. I think it's more than 2 centuries back, right? So wherever they painted it, they wanted to popularize this product, particularly among the young people. So they also started creating a myth of Santa Claus, right? It gripped the imagination of the people, and from America it traveled.